Hi, I'm Eric Schmidt with the League of Women Voters. The League is a nonpartisan organization that has provided voters with unbiased election information since 1920. We've invited candidates to talk with us so you can learn more about them. Joining us now is Rob Wagner. He is a candidate for Oregon Senate District 19, but technically you're the incumbent. You were appointed to that post when Senator Richard Devlin decided to move on to another post.
That's correct, yeah.
And you are on the Lake Oswego School Board, as I understand it.
I do. I serve continually on the school board as my volunteer service on top of my legislative service as a state senator.
So education is a big issue for you.
Education is really the reason why I decided to step forward into public life at all.
Oregon doesn't have a very good graduation rate, high school graduation rate. I think we rank 48th, if I'm not mistaken, in the country. What is the legislature going to be doing about higher graduation rates, bigger class sizes, getting to the heart of education?
Well, and as I mentioned, I think this is a primary reason why I decided to step forward. I come from a family of educators, so going all the way back to my great-grandparents, both of my sisters are teachers. My mom started the education programs at the Friends of Tryon Creek State Park. And then really just looking at my own kids who are in public school, that really is my passion. But you asked about what the solution is. I graduated high school in 1990-1991, the year that Measure 5 passed. And really, since that time, we've seen a systemic disinvestment in public education in Oregon. Also since that time, we've seen corporate revenue as a share of overall funding for schools go from about 17% of the general fund to less than 6%. So I think number one is that we need to look at some additional revenue where we can target specific investments in K-12. But just throwing money at it doesn't necessarily get to solution. And being on a school board and actually looking at the data and looking at the research, we actually know that there are some really important things that we can do. Number one, there's a joint task force right now that's going around the state talking about student success. I just spent 12 hours out in East County, and I was at Reynolds and David Douglas and listening to superintendents and rank and file school board members and teachers and very concerned parents. And what we're finding is the situation for students today didn't look like the situation when I was in school. Homelessness, issues around drug and alcohol dependency, food insecurity. We have to be able to tackle some of those root causes and some of the trauma that students are experiencing in their own lives. I think that's a fundamental piece as a stopgap. The second is critical investments in career technical education. Also, we've seen over the last number of years, students that have realized that you can only be on a college prep track rather than really valuing other types of career opportunities. So I think critical investments in those areas are going to make a huge difference in terms of our graduation rates.
We could talk about that all day, but we've got a whole list
of
questions
to
go through.
Okay, yeah. Oregon, you get me on schools and I'm passionate.
I hear you. Yeah. Oregon has some of the lowest business taxes, corporate taxes in the country. Do you think corporations are pulling their fair share? You mentioned that briefly when you were talking about education.
Yeah, and I'd be glad to spend a little bit more time on it too. This is not a discrediting our private sector job creators. I think it's incredibly valuable that we have local businesses, small businesses, all the way up through our large businesses. Many of my constituents work for Nike and Intel. But if you just look at the data again, since the late 1970s, when corporations paid about 17% of our overall general fund, now they pay under 6%. So I think considering that individuals now pay the massive bulk proportion of our state general fund, I think asking corporations to pay their fair share definitely needs to be part of the solution.
Does tax reform need to be a part of the solution? Do we need to find a third leg to our tax system?
I think trying to find some additional stability is important. I know right now there's been conversations around what are we doing around the kicker, for example. Mm-hmm. It's a very complicated formula, but I do think that having local governments, local school boards, local districts, be able to look at creative solutions to be able to retain some additional revenue to be able to make those strategic investments is really important. I pretty much think that everything needs to be on the table. If everybody comes together around how are we going to find an Oregon way forward, let's find some additional revenue opportunities.
Let's talk about elections for a minute. Not the one you're in now,
sure,
although it could be there. Election integrity is an integral part of our system. Do you think that our election system is being protected? Are we vulnerable to attack?
Well, I think from everything that I've read and researched, Oregon actually does it better than most. I do think that having a paper ballot and having a vote by mail system where you can actually go back and audit and look at sort of the paper trail as it relates to county elections is really important. I definitely think that there's some real considerations if you look nationally. I think Oregon does a good job. I think we're all concerned about what's happening with outside influence just in terms of messaging and social media as well. But I'm not exactly sure what the state can do at that level. But I definitely think that we need to do everything we can to support our Secretary of State in making sure that we have integrity in our election system.
We've arrived at that point on the calendar where we have to redistrict our legislative districts and our congressional districts. Do you think that there should be a nonpartisan group that does that rather than the legislature taking on that task?
I'm not averse to that, but I will say if you just look at the last decennial census and what happened with redistricting last time, again, sort of in this Oregon way, Democrats and Republicans came together and created a redistricting plan that they actually passed through both chambers. And I thought that was really a great solution. We don't see that in other places around the country. So to know that we can actually come together and look at our maps and our boundaries and create fair legislative districts and fair congressional districts where we're not ending up in court, where we're not ending up kind of in a contested frame. I think that Oregon does it well, and I'd rather build on that model to see if we can build bipartisanship rather than necessarily blowing up the system.
A cynic would say that was a one-time only lightning in a bottle. You think it can be replicated?
It's true, but I do. I think that, especially now that we have good data, I think being able to look at communities and saying, oh, a little minor adjustment needs to happen over here, a little minor adjustment needs to happen over there. Obviously, every 10 years, you're gonna have some communities that are growing, and you have to be able to recognize what that looks like. Some communities that are maybe in a little bit more decline in terms of their population. But if you look at the map, there hasn't been massive swings. It's a neighborhood here, it's a neighborhood there, maybe it's a half of a community here. But I think in general, Oregon's done a pretty good job.
Let's talk about transportation because it's a key part of your district. We have a little bit of a congestion problem here in the metro area. What's the legislature gonna help us do to alleviate that?
Well, I'm glad that you only think it's a little problem because when I talk to my constituents, I can tell you they don't think it's a little problem.
How about toll roads? Do they like toll roads?
You know, I'm still open to that conversation. I've only been in the legislature a few months, but I will say the district itself runs from Southwest Portland, Lake Oswego, Westland, and Tualatin, which means in the north, I get I-5 and I get Barber Boulevard. I go all the way down and I have a 6 mile stretch of 205 where you see a massive backup. If you try to drive 205s through the Abernathy Bridge, anytime from about 3:15 to about 6 o'clock in the afternoon, you're gonna be stuck. And so I think we need to look at two things. Number one is let's be creative on how we're providing multimodal and environmentally sound opportunities for people to get to work, to get to jobs, to be able to go pick up their kids. Right now, our congestion problem needs to consider how we can bring more of a kind of environmentally sensitive frame on how people are getting moved around our community. The second thing is I'm definitely open to capacity improvements. So I do think that we need to look at how are we funding improvements to our system, whether or not that's massive infrastructure around bridge repair, but also looking at additional highway capacity. The real question is how are we gonna fund it? So I know that ODOT, the Oregon Department of Transportation, is actually working right now and collecting a lot of input. And I would definitely encourage people to get involved in that conversation. I've seen what happens. I've extended family that live up in the Seattle area. So I know that there's HOV lanes and other things that are under consideration. I'm not opposed to tolling. I just think we need to do it the right way.
But the gas tax ain't cutting it.
It seems like, gas taxes are problematic from a couple different ways. I do think that the Highway Trust Fund has served this state very well for a number of years. And that our inner highway system and our state highways have been really great. I think the problem with the gas tax going forward is that my wife just bought an all-electric. Now, I don't think she'll ever let me actually drive it, but she has an electric vehicle. And what do you do with a gas tax when people are driving around in the Volt or the Tesla or what have you? We need to find additional revenue sources because those cars are also causing congestion and those cars are also having a cost on our road system. So we need to make sure that we're finding a glide path into making sure that we're funding our critical infrastructure.
Last question, very briefly.
Sure.
Are we gonna see anything out of the next session of the legislature for carbon reduction and climate change?
I'm very bullish on the idea that we're actually gonna pass the Clean Energy Jobs Bill. We've been working intentionally around carbon reduction and a lot of those conversations for a number of years. And I think that we're on a pathway to be able to pass a really good piece of legislation that will position Oregon as doing our part in terms of carbon reduction.
State Senator Rob Wagner is a candidate for re-election in Senate District 19. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
We appreciate it.
It's really nice seeing you.
Good to see you.